When I was in second grade, I was invited to a very, very, very special event. It was an event of honor that not everyone was invited to. One day for recess, I was invited to play cartoon tag with everyone else. And it was a special time. It was a real delight for me. And in fact, it became, for most of it was a real joyous memory. You see, as I sat there playing cartoon tag, the idea is that the person who's it would tag you and you would be frozen until you could say the name of a cartoon. And I thought it was the funniest thing I'd ever seen. And at one point, someone said Daffy Duck just the right way. And the joy was gone immediately from that moment because I laughed so hard that it no longer became funny. And that only happens when you lose bladder control. Yes, it's true. There in second grade, in front of everyone, I peed my pants. And it's bad enough to have that happen. The worst part is when you stand in line to go in from recess because then you have the entire class standing there looking at you. And there's verifiable evidence that what just happened is plain for all of them to see. And someone yells out, "Hey, look, Billy peed his pants." Now, I was Billy at the time. So boy, a lot of rough parts of this story. And anyway, so I'm standing there and I remember the shame and I remember the angst of it. And we went inside. And what's interesting is I remember two of my friends standing by my side. We're in the middle of a sermon series called Unconditional. And the idea is, how do you love unconditionally? And I felt an unconditional love from those two friends because when my reputation was gone, they stood by my side. And interestingly enough, 5 years later, I wet my pants again in seventh grade, and no one stood by my side. And I don't know if it's because I didn't have as good of friends or if it was simply because it was a bigger deal when you're in seventh grade and you wet your pants. Today, we want to look at this idea of unconditional. We want to bring it down into the realm of the family. We want to talk with you about what would it look like if we had the building blocks of having unconditional love in the way we relate with our kids and our kids relate with each other and we relate with our spouses. What would it look like if our relationships had some foundational building blocks that would move in a way that would help us to love in an unconditional way? One of the ways we're going to do this today is we're going to look at some key phrases and some key verses from a guy named the Apostle Paul. Now, ironically, I'm saying we're going to look at the building blocks of how do you have healthy relationships in your family. We're going to do this from a guy who never got married and didn't have kids. But the truth of what he says is so profound, it's so foundational for us to have unconditional love. I think it's so pertinent for us to look at it inside of our family. And I want us to be thinking about this in terms of relating to our kids and relating to our spouses. If you're more like the Apostle Paul and you don't have a family that we think of like a nuclear family, I want you to have the freedom to say this fits with every relationship. And as you're working through this, here's what I want you to know, that the things we're going to challenge ourselves with today, they're not things that are natural. One of the reasons they're not natural is because of the nature of the home we grew up in. Every one of us grew up in a home that had something fractured in it. That's just the reality of what we're going through. So some of the things you're going to have to overcome are the way that you were raised. And if you're going to build a different future for your family and for your kids, there's going to have to be some changes that happen. The other thing that has to be overcome in these building blocks is that everyone inside your home is a sinner. And because of that, it's so desperately needed for us to have our eyes centered back on Jesus. We have said over the last few weeks, and I think this is so profound, I so appreciate Paul bringing this up. He said multiple times, he's brought us back to, you cannot give what you have not received. You cannot give what you have not received. Which takes us back to that axiom that we say here all the time at Family Church. The horizontal, how we relate to each other, rests on the vertical. Let's go back to you cannot give what you have not received. You cannot give to others horizontally if you have not received vertically from Jesus. And so we want to come back to that heartbeat. So the first thing I want us to do, we're going to be in Romans chapter 12. We're also going to be in Ephesians and Colossians, all of them written by the Apostle Paul while he was in jail. And he sets out some key phrases for us. And so here's where we are. Let's start with this. Is that Romans 12, chapter 10, it says, honor one another above yourself. At first, I love this idea that we're going to honor and this idea that we're going to esteem. In fact, if you're looking for a definition of honor, the best way to do it is to say to esteem or think of someone else above yourself. And I love this, that it actually uses the phrase above. The reason I think that's so profound is so often in our families, we often talk about don't compare. The reason is if I'm comparing with you, I'm usually trying to put myself above. And then here's Paul. He's actually saying, use comparison, but make sure that you're always the one choosing the bottom. Are you the one that comes beneath and below? And when you're thinking about this, I realize this. If we think of words of honor, it's me speaking to you things that lift you up. But I realize there can be a backhand to that. I want to give a caution. It says to honor one another above yourself. This is a heart issue. Because what you can do is you can say words that say, I'm going to lift you up. But you know what it really is? It's actually flattery. Because what you're wanting is not to lift them up. You're wanting something in response. Man, you look amazing in that dress. Hey, can you make me some cookies? Hey, I'm so grateful for how good you are at fill in the blank. Would you give me? Well, that's flattery. That's not honor. Honor says, I am going to take what you need and put you at the center of it. A couple of things that we see in Scripture, there are moments of honor. And what I'd actually like you to do is I'd like you, in your own devotion time, in your quiet time, I'd like you to look at Scripture and say, where are places that these building blocks come up? One of them comes from a story in Mark 14, a story where Jesus is really, really close to the end of his life here on earth. And someone comes in with a gift. Her name is Mary. Mary comes in with an alabaster jar full of perfume. This would have been the equivalent of about a year's wage. This is incredibly expensive. Think of it in terms of, like, picture it worth $50,000. And the only way to open it and get the perfume out is to break the bottle. She comes into Jesus, breaks the bottle, and pours this anointing oil on his head. This is one of the greatest signs of honor and respect and esteem that she could give in that culture. And I thought to myself, boy, look at her willingness to honor. She does it even though it's costly. And there's a back end to it too. After she does it, she's actually ridiculed by some of the disciples who say, this money could have been used more wisely. Ugh. Mary came in to honor Jesus, to lift him up. And then Jesus says this great line. He says, whenever they tell the story of me, wherever it's told, they're going to tell her part of the story, which is cool. I just got to be a part of it. It's 2,000 years later. I just actually fulfilled what Jesus said. I just got to be part of his prophecy. This idea is honor one another above. So I want you to write this down. Honor above. One of the key building blocks to what we're going to try and do. I want to give you just some real practical things too, just how you can do some of these things in your home. One of them is set up places where you can make sure that you are speaking kindly to each other. I'll give you one that's been, I'm noticing in my family the greater need for it, which reveals a greater need in my life. It's a couple things called please, thank you, and you're welcome. They're called manners. And here's what it does. When someone gives, when someone receives, when any type of transaction happens where something is transferred between, someone does something or gives something, honor that you saw that it happened. You say, thank you, thanks, well, you're welcome. And then when you need something, hey, I realize that you have your own life. You're going your own direction. Would you please step out of your life and please hand me the ketchup? No, you don't have to go that far. But the realization to say is when I'm asking for something, I'm actually saying, would you please give this to me? This wasn't part of their plan for the day, but I'm asking you to step out of that. It's amazing what manners do. I'll give you another cool one from our family. I got this idea from Paul. He called it red plate night. And of course, I'm a Duke fan, so the only color is blue, Duke blue. And the idea of a blue plate is for dinner, someone gets the blue plate. When you get the blue plate, you are in the place of honor. And the place of honor means that we are going to go around the table and say something that we appreciate about you, something that we see in you, and we are going to esteem you, we are going to value you, and we're going to speak it. A cool thing about this is whenever we have a birthday or a Mother's Day or a Father's Day, or even we even do half birthdays, which is really fun because we only tell half of what we appreciate about them. We just say, you know what I really appreciate about you? I love the way that you, and then we just stop, which makes us all giggle. I didn't say it was a good story, but that's what we do. The other thing that we do is when we invite people over, oftentimes we'll make sure that a blue plate lands in front of them. And then we get to say, you know what I really appreciate about you? I'm grateful for the way that you help here. Or I'm grateful for the way that you speak there. It isn't something that happens every day, but when a blue plate comes, it's often a special moment for those people. Another thing that we do, we have a board of honor. And it simply says this. It says, and it has our names on it. There's Anderson and Anna and then my name. Right now, Crystal's the one that has it. And it says, someone other than the person whose name it is writes down, I love you because, and then they write what they appreciate. And right now it says for Crystal, I love you because you care so much. So you care for your kids so well. I'm going to have to work on my learning to read. Yeah. You care for your kids so well. Well, here's what's funny. You know how you get your thing put on there? You're never the one to do it. It's always you thinking of someone else in the family, putting their name up, and then writing on it. Here's what I appreciate about you. That beauty of this with your kids, if you have one of those moments where you see the kid has struggled with something and then they step out and do it well, you get the chance to say, hey, I really, really am grateful that you did this. So another thing that I want to say about this, especially in terms of your family, one of the ways that you can honor is by finding commonality. And the way that you find commonality is often when you step out of what you enjoy and move to what they enjoy. Got a couple of them that I want to show you that will maybe be very helpful in just your thinking, triggering for you. Think about the people in your family. Think about what they like and how you can engage with them in those places. This is what's known as an apparatus called a trampoline. This is the greatest place to build a relationship with one Anderson Irwin. This is where he would rather be than any other place in the world. If you want to get him talking, you could in this place. Actually, we're Irwins, we're always talking. But if you want to have a deeper conversation, be a part of this. Jump around in there. Trampolines are not my favorite place to be. In fact, as I'm getting older, I'm finding this is just another place called a death trap where in my age, I can get hurt more often. But I'll tell you, if you want to engage with my son, this is the perfect place to be. For my daughter, it's somewhere else. My daughter sometimes will spend time on the trampoline. But more than anything, if you want to engage with my daughter, you connect with her over the books that she is reading. And I'll tell you, as I have learned to walk in this world, I've read more youth adult novels than any other time in my life as I have learned to engage and connect with her, which, by the way, side note, just between you and me, Ella Enchanted is one of the greatest books ever written. Don't watch the movie. I'm talking about the book. There's a reason it was a Newbery Honor winner, okay? Amazing book. And we have amazing discussions. We get to connect with each other. The other day, we were having a conversation about racism in America based on what we had read together. And I don't mean we sit down and read simultaneously, but we spend time talking about the books together. You know, as we go on, there is one place that in our home, you can connect. And it's not honor in the same way as the trampoline or books, because I like it just as much. It's a very special place in the Irwin home. There's a galaxy far, far away that our family loves. The moment Star Wars joins the conversation, I would say about right now, 60% of all conversations in the Irwin home or Irwin vehicles include Star Wars or trampoline. This is a place that we all enjoy being, and it is a place, here's what's funny. When you think of it in terms of just watching movies or just reading books or just the trampoline, and you don't realize it's a place of connection, a place of connection is a place of honor. And are you willing to be a part of something that's not necessarily always Star Wars? Are you willing to go onto the trampoline or perhaps read a book that you wouldn't enjoy? When I began reading books with Anna, I'll be honest with you, it wasn't something that I really, really thought I would enjoy. It has become an absolute delight because my value has changed to connect with her value, because that's part of honor. And you know, I said at the beginning, and we look at unconditional, you cannot give what you have not received. I was thinking about this in terms of my relationship with Jesus Christ. What I deserve is I deserve to go to hell. I deserve to be separated from God forever, but Jesus Christ gave his life for me. And he, because of that, I have been adopted as a son of God. I am an heir to the throne of heaven. And my second grade teacher thought I wouldn't amount to anything. Why is it? I have been honored so much by God. And when I realize that and I receive that, it is so much easier to honor others, because I don't need to live in insecurity. I'm a child of the King. I am co-heir with Christ. See, when my perspective changes, when I say I can now give honor because I have received, everything changes. another area that I see, there's a real building block, something that the Apostle Paul pointed out, and this comes from Ephesians chapter 5, and he's really centering in on the family. And as he begins the conversation with the family, he starts by saying, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. And in this passage, he sets out the importance of the hierarchy, that there is a flow for family. Right after he says, submit to one another, he says to wives, wives, submit to your husbands. The husband's going to be the leader of the home. And that's caused a lot of tension, especially in the church in America over the last 80 years or so. But one of the things that we see in this idea, he says, submit to one another. Then he challenges the wives. You know what he says to the husbands after that? He has a higher level of submission. He says, hey, husbands, I want you to love your wife like Christ loved the church and gave himself up for it. Wives are called to submit. Husbands are called to die for their bride, to lay their life down. You know what we call that? We call that submission. If you're looking for a definition of it, the idea is they're sub, and then the root here is the same as mission. Sub means to come under. Mission means their goal. So what does submission look like? Well, first you have to understand why we do it. And I go back to this. You cannot give what you have not received. You cannot give what you have not received. And look what it says right here. Submit to one another. Why? Because of what you've received out of reverence for Christ. Go back to the story. What is the essence of the story the church gives? That we are sinners. God is perfect. We can't have relationship with him, but Jesus Christ died on the cross. You know that he didn't want to do it either? He had no desire. In fact, it even tells us the story, this moment when Jesus, the night before he dies on the cross, he actually is wrestling with whether or not he wants to be a part of this. And he prays a prayer and he says, Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me. And then you hear the submission, yet not what I will, but yours be done. And he says, it's not about me, I'll do it. And Jesus submits and he calls us submit to one another. The idea being that what you want, I will make it what I want. And you see, realize that submission only comes when you disagree, which means, put this in your family. It's your husband. It's the wife. It's the father and son. It's the siblings. One wants to go this way. One wants to go that way. Now we have the makings. This is either going to be a conflict or we will learn to submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Jesus died for us. And here's the essence of submission, the heartbeat of it. You can submit with your body, but not with your heart, and it's not submission. It's just going along. I remember as a 16-year-old, one of the days when Ryan and Joel and Aaron were all gonna go fishing, and I wanted to go. I don't even like fishing, but I wanted to go because the guys were going, and my dad wanted me to clean the garage with him. So I said, I wanna go fishing. My dad said, no, you're gonna stay home and clean the garage. I physically stayed, and I was in the garage. But every turn, I huffed and I puffed and I could not blow the house down, but I rolled my eyes the whole time. In fact, here's what I want you to hear. Submission is always a heart issue and submission is always an unnatural act. I want to read this again, this thing that Jesus said, only I'm going to read it through the eyes of a 16-year-old son instead of Jesus. Father, if you're willing, take this cup from me, yet not what I will. We'll do what you want. You hear the difference? It's the same words. What's the difference? Well, the heart wasn't there. In the same way, when it comes to submission, as we were talking about this yesterday, I thought Heather gave some incredibly wise advice. He said, real submission comes when you say, your win is my win. Your loss is my loss. I'm with you. Let's come back to this idea of values. The same way it happened in honor, it happens at a deeper and core level in submission. What is it you value? Okay, I'm with you. I'm together with you. And out of reverence for Christ, write this down. We're called to submit to. I said that this is an issue of the heart. Here's what's so funny about it. Not only is it an issue of the heart, you don't want to do it, which means you're going to have to lead your heart. And sometimes the thing that you need to do is you're asked to do something. You want to go this way. They want to go that way. You may have to take a step back. Take a deep breath. And get your heart in the place where you can say, okay, I'm with you. And I don't mean just say the words, but you take your heart and say, okay, I'm with you. Isn't this what Jesus did? Both in the garden and on the cross, he did it for us. So we've seen so far the idea of honor, which means I'm going to take what you value and make it my own. And then at a deeper level, we're going to take submission, where you want to go, I'll take it and I will make it my own, and I will value what you value. Well, the last two I want to challenge you with really come when the other two fall apart. Look at what it says in Colossians. This is another letter that the Apostle Paul wrote near the end of his life while he was in prison. He says to us, bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. I know you're already seeing it. You already got it underlined right there. You see this as, how do I forgive people in my family? Just like Jesus did for me. And how did he do it? He did it on the cross. While hanging on the cross, this is what Jesus does. He's hanging on the cross and he looks out over the people and he says, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Here's what I've always wondered. I'm sure scholars will disagree across the board. I often wondered, was he saying forgive them, meaning the Roman soldiers and the Pharisees and the disciples who ran away? Or is he saying something more? Is he also talking about us as we sinned and our sin is what put him there? He says to forgive. Paul says to forgive as the Lord forgave you because, think about it, he wants you to do this because you have received. And he says, when you receive it, then you can give it. In fact, I want to challenge you. Maybe you're in a place right now where forgiveness is really hard. The odds are pretty good. That's an indicator for you that you are having trouble receiving forgiveness. If forgiveness is difficult in the horizontal, it's probably something fractured in the vertical. And I would spend some time evaluating that. I do want to give a caution as we challenge us to forgive. Forgive does not mean staying in a dangerous place. And if there's abuse happening, you need to get out. You need to talk to someone. But for most of us, forgiveness is the thing that covers over the part when honor doesn't happen. This is what makes it unconditional. Because if you want to honor when they honor, if you want to submit when they submit half the time too, that's not unconditional love. And what you're going to need to do when they hurt you is you're going to need to forgive. I'm going to go ahead and tell you what's wrong in your home. And I'm sure you'll agree with me. It's because of all those other sinners in your home. And if they would just stop sinning, everything would be much better in your home. And it's totally true. And there's a second problem, though. It's not just all those other sinners in your home. It's also that sinner in the mirror that you see every day. And one of the reasons forgiveness is so important is because of who we are. That Jesus Christ, though he died for our sins, we're separated from him over here, and God in his perfection here, Jesus dies on the cross and builds that bridge throughout our life after we become followers of him. There is the changing and the transformation, which means we're still sinners and we desperately need forgiveness vertically, and then we have to offer it horizontally. I want to acknowledge something, though. Forgiveness hurts and forgiveness is expensive. And I don't want to belittle what you're hurting from. They were wrong to do that to you. It was wrong. And I'm so sorry for what you're going through. Your pain is real. It matters. But I give you a caution. Though it's real, you may be tempted to stay in it. You remember how I said forgiveness is expensive? So is unforgiveness. And you'll have to make a choice. I want you to know this as well. Forgiveness is an unnatural act, just like submission. And though it's costly and it's painful, it's so important. I so appreciate Jesus' example of this. Not only did he do it when he was hanging on the cross, he did it after he rose from the dead. Specifically speaking about Jesus, he was wounded by all of our sin, but there was one person in particular in his life here on earth that I think caused him one of the greatest wounds, and it came from one of his closest friends. His name was Peter. His name was Simon Peter. And when Jesus was on trial, Peter followed him into the courtyard and three times denied that he knew him. The last time that he denied him, Jesus and Peter lock eyes and Peter knows he's failed him and he runs out and weeps bitterly. Well, then Jesus ends up dying on the cross and 3 days later he rises from the dead, and there's an interaction with Peter where, remember, he had denied him three times. Jesus challenges him three times and says, "Do you love me?" And he calls him Simon again. Essentially, he's saying, "Do you love me?" And gives Peter the opportunity to say, "Yes, you know that I love you," three times. And he reinstates him. And he doesn't use the word, but you know what I see there? "Peter, I forgive you. I forgive you." There's another building block. We've talked about honor, which is to elevate someone else's value. We've talked about submission, which is to come alongside and elevate or come underneath, being willing to go with their direction and their mission. And then we've talked about forgiveness to deal with our sin. There's one more that I see. It actually is the beginning of the verse we started with, Romans 12, verse 10. He says, "Be devoted to one another in love." Oh, what it means to be devoted. You know, when I think about family, you know how I think you can look at it? You can look at it from a perspective of that I am trapped because God hates divorce and God hates disunity. And so you say, well, we'll stick together. I think God calls us to something far more than that. And in fact, when he says, "Be devoted to one another," I think what he's saying is you got to stay all in. This is more than just avoiding divorce. This is more than just letting it go. This is dealing with it. I'm all in. And so the challenge is, we've talked about honor, we've talked about submission, we've talked about forgiveness, but it has to be a devotion. I am committed to you, son. I'm committed to you, mom. I'm with you, dear spouse. I'm with you, my daughter. I'm not giving up on this. And you know, one of the things that I think has to come from this is we have to have a mindset that says, I will do the next right thing. You see, when that fracture comes, when submission didn't happen the right way and someone was dishonored, when forgiveness is a struggle and you're in that place where there's tension and you don't feel like living unconditionally and you're at that moment, maybe you've done a bunch of things wrong today and you want to continue doing wrong things, but you're devoted to this and the Holy Spirit is speaking to you and saying, remember who you are and what I've called you to. That Holy Spirit's whispering to you the heartbeat of devotion. And what we do at that moment is so critical because we have a choice to continue down the path that leads to tension and dissension or to do the next right thing. I'm gonna give away something here, and if you haven't seen Frozen 2, I'm gonna give away part of the story. There's a really sad moment in the movie Frozen 2 where Anna and Olaf are trapped in a cave, and sadly, I'm gonna go and say it to you. Olaf dies, and if you haven't seen the movie, you probably don't care what I'm talking about, but there is a really, really, really cool phrase that Elsa sings. She's stuck in a cave, Olaf is already dead, and there is no way out that she knows. So she can sit in her despair, or she can get up and take a step, and so she sings a song. It simply says those words, "I'll do the next right thing. I'll take a step and step again. I won't give up." And let me tell you, if you're in that moment where the tension is so great, the forgiveness seems so far, will you be willing to say, from this moment, I'm going to change the direction. I'm going to alter and I'm going to go because I'm devoted. You know what it means to change direction? You know the word for it? There's a churchy word for it, a Bible word for it. It's called repent. And I know when the tension's high and the thing that you want to do more than anything, listen carefully, the thing that you want to do is to say that one more thing, to get that one last word, to dig one thing deeper. And the last thing that you want to do is speak with humility and gentleness. Do the next right thing. I've got a couple challenges that I want to give you, and I'd really like for us at every campus to really center in on this idea. What would it mean if I actually lived this out unconditionally? What would it look like if I took what I received and then I gave? Love you, and we will see you soon.